everyone, and welcome to the inaugural edition of Who on Who, the podcast dedicated to the review of classic Doctor Who series DVDs released in the United States, in no particular order. My name is David Hooie, and I'll be your host as we look back on the long and illustrious span of Doctor Who episodes from days gone by. My intentions with this podcast is to focus on the classic series DVD releases and hopefully discuss with you, the listeners, about these episodes. To that end, I ask you, no, I beg you, please, please, send me emails to drwho@charter.net. That's drhoo@charter.net. I'm lonely and I need some friends. Now, seriously, if you are a fan of the new series of Doctor Who, as am I, and you're looking for current series reviews, discussion, and up-to-date Doctor Who-related news, I'd like to point you to my friends at the Gallifreyan Embassy at www.gallifreyanembassy.org or podshock.net. The Podshock podcast stars Louis Trapani, Ken Deep, and James Naughton, and I would never try to step into their rice bowl because they do what they do so well. Also, you can look for Louis Trapani's Sonic News Driver podcast, which delivers up-to-date Doctor Who news in a bite-sized podcast. In this episode, we'll be reviewing the Fourth Doctor adventure, Planet of Evil. I chose to start with this adventure because, well, I received it as a Christmas gift this year, along with a few others, and I've just finished watching it, so it's still fresh in my mind. For those of you who want to keep track with me, this is the Doctor's 81st adventure. And like I mentioned earlier, it features Tom Baker as the Fourth Doctor and Elizabeth Sladen as Sarah Jane Smith, probably one of the Doctor's most famous companions in the entire run of the series to date. So much so that Sarah Jane now has her own spin-off series called The Sarah Jane Adventures, which I also thoroughly enjoy watching and would encourage any of you to give it a tumble. Now, in this story, the TARDIS receives a distress call from the planet Zeta Minor, which is further out in the universe than we've seen the Doctor go so far, or at least we're led to believe that through dialogue. Now, he and Sarah Jane respond to the call and arrive on the planet at the same time as a military ship that has arrived to search for members of a geological expedition that have been stationed there and have not reported into their home world of Morestra. By now, we the viewers know that of the original 8 members in the geological team, only one member remains alive, Professor Sorensen, who led the survey to locate an energy source to replace the dying sun that Morestra orbits. The Doctor and Sarah Jane, of course, are believed to be responsible for the murders of the other 7 people, and that's when all the fun begins. It's well documented in other reviews and on the DVD extras that the plot is a mixture of the film Forbidden Planet and the novella The Strange Case of the Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. During the time of writing, certain science periodicals had been covering the subject of antimatter, and the authors decided to write a story incorporating that element as well. This was the first story for a new season, and the production team expressed a desire to move away from the typical rubber-suited alien theme of previous years and opt for something that could prove to be scary on the basis of having a certain amount of reality, or what I like to refer to as a real face. And while I don't want to spoil the story or give too much away for any of you who haven't seen it yet, I think this is a valid idea, and going by the description of being partially Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde inspired, I'm sure you can assume that at least somebody who is not the Doctor or Sarah Jane is afflicted in a way similar to Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. I think that this is a valid story idea. It's proven itself many times. For instance, you'll find nothing scarier in the new Doctor Who series, in my opinion, than the little boy from The Empty Child, the one with the gas mask who repeats, "Are you my mummy?" which didn't have to rely on heavy CGI effects to elicit emotion from the viewers. Now, for Planet of Evil, the writers went so far as to have more than one monstrous element. The planet itself can also be considered a threat for the Doctor and others to overcome. When you watch this story, I want you to pay particularly close attention to the jungle details on the planet of Zeta Minor. This was all done in studio, and the set decorators discuss it in great detail on the DVD extras. Considering the era and the funding that they had, this was a really impressive set design. Now, I have a couple of continuity notes that I'd like to share with you, and these come according to a Wikipedia entry on the entry planet on the episode Planet of Evil. First of all, this is the first story to feature the Fourth Doctor behind the console of the TARDIS. The TARDIS console room had not been seen on screen since the Third Doctor serial Death to the Daleks in 1974. A refurbished TARDIS console makes its television debut in this story. The Doctor also quotes from Romeo and Juliet and Hamlet, and he says that he met William Shakespeare prior to the Bard taking up writing. Now, if this is taken at face value, this would suggest that the Doctor met Shakespeare prior to the events of the Shakespeare Code set in 1599. For all you continuity buffs out there, this could present a little bit of problem between classic series and new series, so I'd be interested to hear your comments regarding this by emailing me again at drhoo, that's dr.hoo, at charter.net. The DVD actually has several decent extras on it. It's got a wonderful commentary track with Tom Baker, Elizabeth Sladen, the producer, Philip Hinchcliffe, and Prentice Hancock, which was recorded on Friday, the 26th of January, 2007. It also includes a 25-minute documentary called A Darker Side, which goes into a lot of the details regarding the studio location, set design, planning, production of the story, and a lot of interesting background into how this story came about. There's also an Easter egg on this DVD called Hidden Hinchcliffe. Now, for those of you who don't know, Easter eggs are little hidden extras that are put on DVDs and are actually fairly common in the classic Doctor Who series DVDs. You can usually find one or two per disc. The way that works normally is on a regular DVD menu where it appears you can only, say, go up and down to choose options. If you try moving your remote left and right or just on different screens, trying different options, if something unusual highlights on the screen, go ahead and select enter on your remote or hit your select button or whatever it's called for your particular remote, and that will take you to the DVD Easter egg, which is, like I said, just a hidden bonus. I'm not going to spoil for you where the Easter egg is hidden on this disc, but give it a try. See if you can't find it. If not, drop me an email. I'll be happy to write you back and let you know where the Easter egg is located if you're interested in looking at it. Now, overall, my thoughts on this episode, I'd like to say that while the Fourth Doctor tends to be hit or miss for me, I know I'm probably going to get a rash and you-know-what from folks about that, because for many people, especially American Doctor Who fans, Tom Baker was their Doctor. But personally, I think he stayed in the role a little too long. Overall, Tom Baker was in the role for 7 years, and I tend to enjoy his earlier adventures as the Doctor, more so than the later episodes, like Keeper of Chalkin, Legopolis, episodes like that. He didn't seem to bring as much energy to the role later on, and I guess that's to be understood. He was older, he'd been doing it for a long time, I think some of the excitement had worn off. I generally like to side with the opinion of most of the actors that after 3 years or so, it's probably getting ready for you, about time to move on and let somebody else take over the role. But in this episode, that's not the case. Again, this is still very early on in Tom Baker's tenure as the Doctor. He still puts a lot of excitement, a lot of energy into his part. All of the actors do very well. I would have to say that there's not a lot of unnecessary scene chewing or overacting by anyone. This is classic Doctor Who. For those of you who love this kind of story, and I'm one of them, the Doctor swoops in at the beginning of the story. There's a misunderstanding as to who exactly he is and why he's there and what he's all about. That gets cleared up eventually, and the Doctor saves the day in the end, like really only the Doctor can. But it's a great story, considering, again, the era in which it was created. The writing is excellent. How it was presented on screen with the effects that they had. Keep in mind that these DVDs, again, these stories predate computer-generated effects. So you have to take that into account when you're watching some of these classic stories. But overall, I think Planet of Evil was very well realized on screen and definitely well worth a purchase. Now, that brings me to the close of our first episode of Who on Who. I hope you enjoyed listening, and I hope that you will consider dropping me a line and giving me some feedback. Let me know what you think about Planet of Evil, if it's one that you've seen recently or one that you have on DVD and know very well. Also, let me know what other episodes you would like to have me review on the podcast. And just like to hear any general comments at all. So again, drop me a line. That's drhoo@charter.net. You can also check out my blog at whodvdreview.com. That's whodvdreview.com, all one word. And I look forward to hearing from you very soon. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time. Bye-bye.